Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bethel here and online. We're delighted to be with you this morning. Before we get started with our worship service, we thought we'd start with our announcements this morning. We just have a few things. For all of our board, a reminder that our board meeting is this Tuesday evening, and we are meeting live or on Zoom for anybody who still wants to have that option, but we're hoping to get some of us together live down in the fellowship hall. Wednesday night, we still have our Bible study going, and I know they're in the midst of a fantastic study right now, so if you're interested in that, let us know. A couple of other fun announcements. Yesterday was the Camp Lael 5K to support their scholarship fund. And as of yesterday, they had raised over $2,600 to support new campers coming to the camp. And just a fun fact for our church, Bethel was one of the number one church represented.
Number one.
We showed up as we always do to support our friends at Camp Lael. The church is still sponsoring or adopting Camp Lael for the month of September, so we are still collecting money that we plan to send to the camp for however they see fit to use for their needs there at the camp beyond scholarships. So continue to give to us and mark those donations for Camp Lael, and then we'll make sure they get them at the end of the month, and we'll give an update on how that went. Couple things coming up on Saturday, October 10th, as part of the ABCMI annual gathering, Bethel is participating in an event called Send Me Saturday. And we're partnering with First Baptist Church of Wyandotte, and we're going to be working together to clean up some local parks. Details are kind of being finalized on that, but it's going to happen on October 10th in the morning, like 10 to 12, I think, is the commitment time. So mark your calendars. We're going to come out, and we're just going to show the communities that these churches are working together and that God is still on the move, even all this crazy stuff. And then towards the end of the month, right before Halloween, we're planning to do a drive-in movie night here at Bethel for the kids. Right now we're looking at October 24th as a date, so mark your calendar, and much more info to come on those. And now let's stand and worship together. Our scripture today is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 28, verse 16. Behold, I am lying in Zion, a stone, a tested stone, a costly cornerstone. For the foundation firmly planted, he who believes in it will not be disturbed.
Worthy is Father God, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for the ability to come to you and to worship you, Lord. And Lord, just as that song says, we are so grateful for all the things that you've done for us. Lord, we are just in awe of how you've brought us to this place, Lord, and that you have provided a way for us to talk to you, Lord. And we know that you are working in our lives and working in this church, and we thank you for the blessing of that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Please be seated. Remind you that you can give to the church by sending us a check, by donating through your bank draft, or by donating online through our website. Here in the sanctuary, you can drop your envelopes in the plates on your way out this morning to support our ministries and the things that we're doing here at Bethel.
Good morning, everyone. How can we pray for one another this morning? Yes, Marty. Haji is in the hospital. He's taking visitors. For those of us that know him, we're not sure what's going on yet with him, but he's been in the hospital a long time. There was a danger of him losing his leg from his diabetes, so we want to keep him up in prayer and keep praying for him. Jim has been moved this week from ICU to a regular room, so he's recovering there, and he is aware. We played some Beethoven for him earlier this week, and he was conducting from his bed, so that's good news, but we don't think he's going to get out of that bed again. He's going to be in the bed for however long his life is, so we want to pray for him and lift up Chris as she struggles with this, and Cindy, his daughter, has come in to help in the household, so we want to pray for all of them. How's Kathy doing? Kathy is much better. So she's restarted radiation, and chemo starts tomorrow. At a lesser dosage. Okay. All right. So keep them in prayer. Pray that this is effective. We praise God for all the running that happened at Lael yesterday, and there was a lot more running than you might think. I know Rachel was running, and she said, I'm tired, I can't run anymore. And I went, ah! And man, she was running twice as fast as she was before. Boy, so we want to keep praying for camp. That's our mission for this month, and lift them up and give them, try to give them an opportunity to do keep doing the miracles that they have been doing in our church for a long time. Don. Dot. Dot is still recovering. She's up and down. Today is her birthday. We were going to sing to her, but she didn't feel up to it. So is it too late to sing happy birthday? Well, if Todd says it, we got to do it. But somebody else better start the song off. You want to start the song off? Amy's going to do it. Praise God. So we'll pray. We're going to pray. We're going to sing for Dot. Okay, Dot? He can stand if he wants to. He can stand. It's all right. All right.
It's also Kylie's birthday today.
It's also Kylie's birthday today.
And
is she at home?
Logan's birthday too.
And Logan's birthday.
Oh my goodness. All right.
Wow. So, ready? For all of these birthdays and the one that's happening tomorrow, which is Pierce, let's sing.
Happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you, every day of the year, may you find Jesus here. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you, and the best you've ever had.
All right, praise God. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer with these praises, petitions, and ask the Lord to do what he does. Lord, we are so grateful that you are the God who cares, that you are a God who listens. We pray that you give us your power, that you put your healing power in those people in our church that need it so badly. We pray for the birthdays that have come up that we're talking about here and birthdays that come up every week, that people have celebrate the life that you have given them, the love that you pour out upon them, and help them to see where you are working in their lives and in the life of this church. We pray your blessings upon us as we seek your face, as we seek to follow you through these difficult times and touch the people who are listening here and who are here this morning. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. So far in Peter, we have talked about being holy. We are to be holy. We are to be fearful. We are to be loving. Those are the three commands from chapter 1 that Peter wants us to do. You have to be these three things. We've discovered that holiness is a relationship. You only get holiness when God is in you. Holiness is a relationship. Say, holiness is a relationship. Holiness is a relationship. Whatever God is in becomes holy. So when he's in me, I am holy because God is in me. When he's in you, God, you are holy because God is in you. All right. And because you are holy, Peter wants us to understand that what you do matters. Once he's in you and he's working through you, you make a difference. You matter. So I want you to say, I matter. I matter. You matter. Now tell your neighbor that they matter. You matter. You matter. God is in you. You matter. This brings us the reminder of Jesus' commandment, love one another. So we are to love one another. Peter's going to push us further. Before I tell you the journey that Peter wants us to go on, which is going to go on for some time, not just this sermon, I want to remind you that because God is in you, the journey that God wants you to take, you can do it. Because God is in you. Now, in your own life and under your own power, you probably wouldn't be able to make this journey. But because God is in you, you can make the journey. God is rooting for you. I'm rooting for you. The church, all of us, we're rooting for each other. Amen? We're rooting for each other. You can make it no matter where the journey takes you. You have no idea where the journey is going to take you. Sometimes the journey isn't pleasant. Sometimes it isn't direct. It's never what you expected. You know, I have a friend of mine, Ward, and I, we spent some weeks in Green Lake, Wisconsin. We flew out to Wisconsin to the American Baptist Assembly, and we were there camping for a couple of weeks. And we flew back. We got on our plane in Madison. We got on the luggage in Madison. We're changing planes in Milwaukee to fly to Detroit. Should take just a couple of hours, just a short flight, right? So we got on our plane in Madison. We landed a little late in Milwaukee, and we went straight to the gate. And when we got to the gate, they said, you can't get on this plane. It's full. And we're like, but we have tickets. But we were checked in when we were in Madison. Well, you cannot get on this plane now. It's full. So what do we do? And the airline apologized. We were talking about trying to just get home. And we were two 16-year-olds at that time. They refunded us all the money we had spent on the plane tickets, the round trip tickets, not just the one way. They gave us all that money, and we had that in our pocket. And we said, can you just tell our parents that, you know, when they come to get us that we're going to be late? The airline said, sure, we'll tell them. So now we're in the airport, right? Two hungry 16-year-olds, money in our pockets. We went out, we had steak, we had ice cream, we drank pina coladas, we were just spending money all over the place. We waited for the next flight. We couldn't get on that flight. We waited for the next flight, couldn't get on that flight. They decided, after about 7 hours of waiting there in the airport, he says, you know, it's probably easier to get to Detroit from Chicago. Really? So they put us on a flight to Chicago. So there we were in Chicago. Steak, ice cream, Mountain Dew. Oh, man. And so we waited there. Next flight to Detroit, full. Next one after that, full. Next one after that, full. They finally, we were there probably 12 more hours. They found a flight for us to get back to Detroit, but it was in Milwaukee. So they flew us from Chicago back to Milwaukee. And at that point, we had run out of money. we were feasting. I mean, 16-year-olds are hungry. So we had spent all our money, and we were like, well, we're not quite sure where our parents are to get in. Can you send a message back? And they said, sure, we'll send a message back. We didn't know that in Detroit, Ward's parents were supposed to come pick us up, and they came to pick us up, and they saw our luggage get off the plane, and they went to the carousels, and they picked our luggage out, and they waited for us, and we weren't there, and they went to the airlines, and they said, two 16-year-olds were supposed to get off this plane, and they looked on their, no, they got on the plane. Well, you know, we did get on the plane in Madison. We didn't get on the plane in Milwaukee. And so they're looking, and so they're trying to find us. And after a few hours, they decided they put out a call because we weren't on the plane. They searched the airport at Detroit. They got the police involved, and then they send a message back to Milwaukee, and they started announcing on all the loudspeakers, you know, Paul Langford, Ward K, where are you, where are you, where are you? But at that time, we were in Chicago when they were announcing and looking for us, so we weren't there. And so we came back and landed in Detroit, and his parents weren't there. We're like, why aren't his parents here? I mean, didn't the airline tell them what was going on? Weren't they supposed to tell them? Then we had to borrow some money from one of the stewardesses that coming off the plane to phone home because we had used all of our money from the flight on steak, ice cream, and Mountain Dew. And called his parents, and they were just this close to getting the Detroit police involved trying to figure out where we were. I mean, a journey you take, you have no idea where it's going to take you, right? You don't know where you're going to end up sometimes. But if God is in you, you have the power to make it. You can make it all the way back to Detroit. That's good news, right? For those of us who live in Detroit, that's good news, getting back to Detroit. Full flight, all of that problem. Because we are now holy and loving, we can do what God calls us to do next, which is remake ourselves. God is in the process of reshaping you, reshaping me through our experiences in life. But he also wants us to help in the process of reshaping us. We are not the person we were born, God means us to be. God loves us just the way we are, but he loves us too much to leave us that way. And in the journey of changing ourselves into someone more like Christ or someone more like the person God pictures us to be, we are supposed to help. We're supposed to help God change us. Say that with me. We're supposed to help. We're supposed to help. We're supposed to be helping God. what we do instead is we give God excuses. You know, it's just not me. Have you ever heard people say that? Or, oh, I've never been able to stop doing that. Or, it's just me, and you'll have to accept it. God doesn't accept it. And he doesn't expect you to accept it. He wants you to participate in transforming yourself. God doesn't expect us to overlook our foibles, our quirks, or our sins. We're to try to do something about it. The small sins and the big sins. Big sins. You hear that? I said big sins. Big sins. Peter, when he looks at the first century church, he sees malicious gossips, deceitful liars, hypocrites, envious people sniping at those they want to be like, slanderers who don't care who they hurt. How do I know that's what Peter sees? Because of this verse, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. If they weren't malicious, deceitful, hypocritical slanderers, Peter wouldn't have written this verse. Got that? He never would have written this verse. So we have to accept it. We have to own it. As a church, as all churches, our churches are filled with these kind of people. Our churches are filled with these kind of people. I say good. Pastor Paul, you didn't mean that. You want malicious people in our church? You want liars and hypocrites? Yes, I want them in our church. Give me your tired liars, your poor gossips, your disenfranchised hypocrites. Bring them into the church. Because I think the only place people can learn how not to lie, that is, embrace the truth, how not to gossip, that is, to become encouragers of the faith, how not to be hypocrites, that is, to become a new, authentic person, is in the church. The only place they can learn how not to be those things is in the church. If they're not in the church, they will continue to be all of those things. We will continue to be all of those things. We need to be in the church. Is there anywhere else in the world that teaches people how not to lie, how not to be hypocrites, how not to be malicious? I mean, think about it. Junior high, you learn how to lie in junior high. Ooh, man, the lies I told in junior high. Don't you guys do that. Oof. We teach junior highers how to lie. In high school, high schoolers gossip. Man, the gossip that goes on, the way they snipe and are mean and malicious to each other. Man, college students, we teach college students how to be hypocrites. You don't learn authenticity in college. You learn how to fake it. You learn how to mimic your professor's opinions rather than your own. And a lot of times, people don't speak out. You learn how to blend in. That's what we teach. So, does your job, what about your job? You think about those of us who are adults. Your job, does your job teach you how not to be these things? Your job may teach you how to be a good plumber, but does it really teach you how not to be a hypocrite or a liar or malicious? I think only the church can change people like this. This is the only place, really, where we can learn how not to be these things. So we need to bring those people, we need to bring ourselves, according to Peter, into the church and stop doing these things. Bring them into a church where they can be changed. Bring ourselves into the church where we can be changed. It's easy to teach someone to lie. It is hard to teach them to embrace the truth, especially when telling the truth will cost them something. Come into the church. Rid yourselves of these bad habits, big sins and small sins. Peter adds this thought. Verse 2. Like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Peter is talking to believers now, this passage. He's talking to those of us who are in the church who believe in Jesus Christ. You've come into the church, you have a relationship with Jesus, so you're holy. Now that you are holy, since you've tasted spiritual milk, Jesus offers new believers something better. That is, he wants us to grow up. Peter says, grow up. Don't be spiritual babies your whole life. Grow up. Don't keep crying and pouting and bickering. Grow up. You know, some of the most childish behavior I've ever seen in my life has come from adults, right? I mean, we see adults behaving like children. Oh, I won't sit at a table with that woman. I've heard someone say that to me. That woman? And I look over to the person they're talking about and says, that's a kind, nice person as far as I can tell, but she won't sit at the table with them? Or someone's come up to me and says, you know, that man hates you. That man hates me. He's always saying you're a terrible person behind your back. I've had people come and say that to me. That so hates me. Someone hates me. You know what I like to do with people who hate me? I like to be as nice and as loving as possible. And there's two reasons I just learned to love on the person who hates me. One is it drives them crazy. They really hate me. Why are you being so nice? And the other is Christ loves them. What Christ loves, I love. And it doesn't matter how they behave, I love them. People hate you, you're in good company. People hated Jesus. People persecute you unrighteously, you're in good company. They persecuted Jesus. People work against you with lies, slander, gossip. They did the same thing to Jesus. That other person you're having a problem with, this is what Peter wants us to understand. I mean, we understand Jesus. He talks about Jesus being the living stone, the cornerstone on which the church is built, the rejected cornerstone on which the church is built, the perfect living stone rejected by men, chosen by God, precious to God. That's Jesus. That other person you have a problem with, they are either chosen by God, that is, they believe in Jesus and are chosen by God, and therefore you should love them, or they are an unbeliever, in which case they are still precious to God, and we are to love them and treat them as precious. They are chosen by God or precious to God. And yet I've heard people say, you know, I just find that person odious. And the reason that word sticks in, because you don't hear that word often, but someone came up, I just find that person odious. Odious. We're all odious to God. Our sin, our problems, our difficulties, our selfishness, our pride. And yet God still loves us. And so we should love them. Put aside malice, deceit, envy, hypocrisy, and slander. Stop being a spiritual baby. Follow Christ. Become the church. That's Peter's push. Become the church. Jesus was the living stone. And you all, I am, we are all living stones in which Jesus fashions us into the church. Now, we may think about ourselves as being this quaint little church, this nice little whitewashed church with the steeple on top. I know we're a red church, but I'm just trying to paint a picture, right? So we may think of ourselves as that, but that's not what God wants us to be. This building is a beautiful building, but we, the living stones, are to be fashioned as something bigger. We are to be a light that will draw all people unto us. How high does our steeple have to be in order for all people to be drawn? We are to be a door for the whole world to enter. How much love do we have to have a door big enough to have the whole world come through? We are to be the bread of life. How much food, that is, how much of ourselves are we to give in order to feed the whole world? This isn't a small little quaint church. Jesus wants to be a cathedral. He wants us to be huge. It used to be men and women aspired to be great people of God. They wanted to be mature, useful, kind, gentle, loving, wise, power-filled. What the world treasures now is immature babies who only think of themselves. God wants to make you and me into something greater. We don't see it that way often. Sometimes we're scared, we're hurt. Sometimes we're sick and we're sinners. Like the lion with the thorn in its paw, we can't sit still long enough for someone to take it out. In a way, we're affected by how the world responds to the gospel. Here's how Peter pictures that. I mean, it's one thing to be the person on the white horse with the armor and the knight that comes in and saves the day. But that's not how we are. That's not who Christians are. Often, the world responds to Christians and the message we bring to the world with violence, rejection, and hate. Here's what Peter says, 1 Peter 2, verse 6. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone that causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. Anyone who trusts in the stone will not be put to shame. However, that same stone is a stumbling block for those who don't believe. There are millions of people who cry out, 'Why do I keep tripping over this Jesus? Why do I keep running into this Jesus? Why do I keep hearing about this Jesus? Can't this just stop? Do I need to keep hearing and knowing and running into him all the time?' He is the rock that makes them stumble, the stone that makes them fall. His message is simple, it's logical, it's uplifting, it gives a person purpose and destiny, and they don't want to listen. They cover their ears, they cover their eyes, and they keep falling down. The message trips them up. It's designed to do that. It's designed to get their attention. We are part of that message. Jesus is the cornerstone, but we are the bricks that make up the rest of the temple, the rest of the church. We are the bricks. And since they can't get at Jesus directly, often they come after us, because they know we're connected. If we act like the world does, immature, petty, violent, that is malicious, lying, hypocrites, they will never see the Jesus that can save them. 1 Peter 2, verse 9, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that, though they may accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us." We have to move from milk to meat. We have to figure out how to grow up. What does this look like? If you are a Christian who has never shared the gospel, we are to share it. Wait, let's go back a step. Milk. What's milk? What might be considered this milk that Peter's talking about? The Bible, that's Bible study for some of us. That's learning how to pray for some of us. That's learning about God. All of these are good things. All of these are things you want in your life in abundance. But the meat is sharing the gospel, that's helping the poor, that's feeding the hungry, that's visiting the sick, that's singing in the choir. More than that, it's singing tenor in the choir. Bringing people to sing in the choir. Bringing people in the church to hear. Bringing others in the church so they might know the miraculous things that we have seen. You are a chosen people. Milk. Milk is what you eat. It's feeding yourself. Meat. Meat is feeding other people. Is there something wrong with the mic?
Can you just use the other mic?
Milk is feeding yourself. Meat is feeding other people. Jennifer and I had a debate about this exactly. She read the sermon and we talked about this a little bit. And then I pointed out that it's you know, Jill Briscoe, one of her heroes, talks about this very thing. It's good to know the Bible. It's good to pray. We should do it every day. But we've been made to share that news, to share the gospel with other people. We've been made to help other people with their needs, to put our own needs aside, to imitate Christ and to do what he did. Now, Jill Briscoe was a new Christian for, what did we say, a week? And she brought 12 other people to Christ. That's meat. What do you need to be able to do that? The love of God in you, that's all. And if you don't know the answer, you know somebody who does have the answer. Bring them to that person. It's another way to get Christ into them. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Act like it. Peter tells us to praise the one who called us out of darkness. Peter says, praise the one who gave us mercy. Peter says, remember, we are exiles and foreigners in the world. Peter says, abstain from your sins. That is, live one day at a time. That's what abstain really means, right? I can't sit down some of the sins that I commit over and over and over again. I can't conceive, you know, just like the alcoholic. I can't conceive of never doing that again, maybe. It's in there in the head. It's in my habits. But I can wake up this morning and say, I won't do this today. Which is how most alcoholics wake up, right? Today, I will not drink. Today, I will not commit this sin. Abstain from sin. Live one day at a time. Don't look at your eternity just yet. At least not in that way. Live a great life, which includes loving much. Live in such a way as the world takes notice of your love. The verses that Peter uses to support his argument, it's from Psalm 118. The rock that makes people stumble. Jesus quotes that too. Jesus says the stone in Matthew 21:42. All right, there's Matthew 18. There we go. Let me do the Matthew 18 first. Psalm 118. Go back to that. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Jesus quotes that too from Matthew. Matthew says, Jesus said to them, have you never read the scriptures? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce fruit. Anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. If we will not be fashioned into the church, Jesus will go somewhere else and do that. Do I say that's going to happen here in our church? No, I think our church is a loving church. I think we are answering the call to feed God's people, to help one another, to visit one another. But there are churches out there that might be in danger. There are people out there that might be in danger. Jesus says he's going to work with those who want to work with him. And if you're not willing to work with him, he'll just find somebody else. Has God changed you since you became a Christian? Has God changed you? Are you a different person because you began this journey? Do you see evidence that God has worked in your life? Are you in Milwaukee or Chicago? Or have you finally reached God's holy land, Detroit? Where are you? The story goes that when they built the first temple in Jerusalem, the stonemasons were cutting the stones and sending them to the bricklayers on top of Mount Sinai, right? Not Mount Sinai, Temple Mount. When the builders got there to start assembling all the stones, they found a stone already there, and they had to move that stone in order to start putting up the temple. And the masons would cut the stones in the quarry and send them, and then the builders were just supposed to put the stones together. You see, God has a law in the Old Testament. You cannot build an altar to God with stones cut with man's hands. You can only use stones that God has cut. And in the olden days, in Moses' time and Joshua's time and up into David's time, if you wanted to build an altar to God, you had to find stones on the ground and stack them up to make an altar. You couldn't carve them in any way. When they started building the temple, what God did was His Holy Spirit entered into stonemasons. And because God's Spirit was in them, they could cut the stones because God was actually cutting those stones and not them. And they could use the stones cut by the stonemasons. But once you sent it up to Temple Mount and the builders started assembling them, they weren't allowed to change those stones at all because they had already been cut by God's hands. And they took the stones and they started trying to arrange them in the temple. This way it didn't work, and this way it didn't work. And they got frustrated because the stones wouldn't fit together. They sent word back down to the masons. Look, you're sending up stones, and we cannot build the temple with what you've given us. What we need is a good cornerstone, and from there we can start to build the temple. Would you please carve the cornerstone? The masons sent a message back up to Temple Mount. They said, we carved the cornerstone. We put it in place for you so that you could start with that. It was the stone the builders had rejected. They came and they thought it was in the way. But it wasn't in the way. It was the one to show the way. That's the stone you put the other ones on. That's the stone you take, you know, the 90-degree angle for to make the building and make the walls. The stone the builders rejected was the cornerstone to build the temple. The world rejects that cornerstone. When they sing about it in Psalm 118, they're talking about that stone there, but he's also talking about Jesus. We reject that cornerstone often. We don't want to be remade. We don't want to have God's hands cut us and to shape us into what He needs us to be in order to build His temple. Psalm 118:22, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Isaiah 28:16, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a tested stone, a costly cornerstone for the foundation, firmly placed. He who believes in it will not be disturbed. Acts 4:10-12. Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you have crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name this man stands here before you in good health. He is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. 1 Peter 2:4. And coming to him as a living stone which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God,
You also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. The cornerstone has been laid. If we don't conform to the cornerstone, we cannot be made into the church. We cannot be made into his image. The church will fall. But the only hands that can change the stones of the living temple is God's. Let him remake you. Help him. Put off your past and present sins. Love one another. For all of us who believe are one nation. All of us who believe are one people. All of us who believe are priests in his presence, delivering the good news to a desperate world. And our world is desperate. They need to hear what we have. They need to know what we know. They need the gifts that have been given to us to use to help them. Let us dedicate ourselves to putting aside the sins and moving forward and doing what God has called us to do. Our singers are going to come up. We're going to sing a final song and then we'll have our benediction. Would you please stand?
Thank you. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name, and everyone said,
Amen. Amen.